Good morning, everybody.
Myself is Professor Dr. Rajendra Deshpande. We are in the Ayurveda College, Nigdi Pradhikaran, Pune 44. With me are the PG students, postgraduate students, who are doing the MD in Ayurvedic Physiology. And we are discussing about some aspects with their syllabus, and which are also useful for the medical practitioner as well as medical teachers and students. We are discussing the Kriya Sharira final year students. The four paper are there, four question papers for university examination. And paper four is modern physiology and its applied aspect. Paper number four, modern physiology and its applied aspect. There we have the general physiology, and then the second point is physiology of neuro immune endocrine mechanism. The title is Physiology of Neuroimmune Endocrine Mechanism. So naturally it will start with the nervous system. But today, on the 23rd May 2018, the day is Wednesday, we are concentrating, or we are starting with the physiology of endocrine system. The points mentioned in the CCM and MUHS syllabus are physiology of endocrine system, classification and characteristics of different hormones, description of hormone secreted by hypothalamus, then the pituitary gland, thyroid gland, parathyroid gland, pancreas, adrenal glands and their physiological effects. And also there is a mention of effects of hypo and hypersecretion of various hormones. So this is in general the points. We will start step by step. First will be the part of introduction, and in that introduction I would like to tell you about what is exactly meant by hormone and mechanism of action. Mechanism of action of hormone. So what is hormone? Hormone is a chemical messenger. In one word, if anybody asks you, what is hormone? Hormone is a chemical messenger, and it may be of three different types. Chemical messenger can be protein. Chemical messenger can be polypeptide, or chemical messenger can be steroid. So these are the three varieties of the hormones. This is chemical messenger, protein, polypeptide or steroid in nature, and secreted by ductless gland. This is specialty of endocrine, that is ductless gland. What does it mean by ductless gland? That means these hormones are directly poured in the blood. These messengers, these chemicals are directly poured in the blood. Through the blood, they reach the target organ. Through the blood, these hormones reach the target organ, and then they modify the functions of that organ. These chemical messenger hormone, they modify the functions of that target organ. For example, if we are talking about thyroid stimulating hormone, TSH, where it will act? On the thyroid gland. So it will be coming through the blood and it will change the function of thyroid gland. Okay. So once again we will try to complete definition. So hormone is a chemical messenger, either protein, polypeptide or steroid, secreted by ductless glands, directly poured into the blood, reaches the target organ and then modify the functions of that particular organ. Now mechanism of action. But mechanism, there are two separate mechanisms. One is for the protein hormones and another is for the steroid hormone. How they will act? It is totally different. Protein hormones, they act differently, and steroid hormones, they act differently. First about the protein or polypeptide. The another name for the protein is a polypeptide chain. Okay. The hormones are having specific receptors on the cell membrane. These hormones, they have the receptor who will receive that hormone on the cell membrane. What will happen? Hormone will come through the blood and get attached to that particular receptor. So hormones attach to the receptors. This will cause the stimulation of the enzyme. And which enzyme? That adenyl cyclase. The name is different. It is not ACH. It is adenyl cyclase. That particular adenyl cyclase, the enzyme is in the cell membrane. So that particular enzyme is get stimulated. Adenyl, A-D-E-N-Y-L cyclase. What happens then? It converts ATP, that particular energy, into the cyclic 3-5-AMP. So ATP will convert it to the cyclic 3-5-AMP. This stimulates different physiological actions like activation of enzymes, change the cell permeability, and naturally further is a muscle contraction or relaxation. So protein, sometimes even it can stimulate to the protein synthesis or release of secretions. Actually, protein hormones, if you want the examples, first example is a growth hormone. This is a protein hormone. Second is ADH. Antidiuretic hormone is also protein hormone. PTH, parathyroid hormone, is also the protein. And catecholamines. Do you know what is catecholamines? Adrenaline and noradrenaline. So nearly 80% hormones are protein in nature. Which one? Growth hormone, ADH, PTH, catecholamines. So all these hormones, how they act? Again, I will repeat. There are specific receptors on the cell membrane. Remember, on the cell membrane. There is one enzyme, that is adenyl cyclase. Whenever there is a ASE, that is enzyme. So adenyl cyclase is enzyme stimulated. What happens with the stimulation? Energy is converted. ATP is converted to the cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP. This is a conversion of energy. And that energy stimulates many processes. One change will be cell permeability will be changed. Muscle contraction, relaxation will take place. Protein synthesis, protein release will take place. And some other secretions also will come from the gland. So all these 5-6 functions will happen because that hormone is coming to the cell membrane. Protein hormone action basically starts on cell membrane. This should be in your mind. Now we will talk about the mechanism of steroid hormone. Two separate mechanisms you must tell to the examiner. One is protein hormone mechanism. Second is steroid hormone mechanism. Steroid hormone don't stop at the cell membrane. They directly enter through the cell membrane. This is the first difference. Do you understand? Protein hormone was stopping at cell membrane. Steroid hormone directly enters inside the cell membrane or inside the cell, crossing the cell membrane. This is the main difference. Then it combines with intracellular receptor. So what is the biggest difference? Protein hormone receptors are on cell membrane. Steroid hormone receptors are inside the cell. Is it clear? So they attach to the receptor but inside the cell. Of course, all these receptors means protein molecules. Remember, receptors are nothing else. Receptors are protein molecules. So these hormones attach with that protein molecule. Then hormone receptor complex together. Two molecules are joined. Hormone receptor complex move towards the nucleus. Nucleus is inside. It's going to the nucleus and stimulates the formation of messenger RNA. It stimulates the messenger RNA, mRNA. It is called as a mRNA. Previously in protein, how it was acting through the adenyl, that particular enzyme, adenyl cyclase. But here, that complex going to the nucleus and it stimulates the formation of messenger RNA. This is protein. So this messenger RNA then increase the protein and enzyme formation. That stimulates the enzyme and protein formation. So what are the examples of these steroid hormones or the cholesterol hormones? One is testosterone or androgens, male hormones and female hormones. From male it is testosterone, in females estrogen and progesterone, and last is a glucocorticoids. Glucocorticoids. So these four examples of steroid hormone. I hope you have understood the difference in mechanism of action of protein hormones and mechanism of action of steroid hormones. Now, third category, other hormones. For example, thyroid hormone. What is that thyroid hormone? Iodinated thyrosine molecules. Iodinated thyrosine molecules. They are little bit similar to the steroid hormone. They are similar to the steroid hormone. They act at nuclear level and increase messenger RNA. It's very similar. Thyroid hormone is not a protein, is not a steroid, but its action is very similar to the steroid hormone. What is thyroid hormone? Iodinated thyrosine molecules. Similar action like steroid hormone. Act at nuclear level and increase the formation of messenger RNA, mRNA. Now fourth, insulin hormone. Insulin hormone has membrane receptors like protein. Insulin is a protein. So insulin hormone is a very specific hormone. So we are discussing separately. It has a membrane receptors on the cell, and when hormone get attached to alpha unit of receptor, there is specific type, alpha unit of receptor, beta unit shows autophosphorylation. Beta unit shows autophosphorylation and protein kinase activity. Protein kinase activity. And because of this, there is an increased or altered membrane permeability for glucose. So if somebody asks you, tell me the action of the insulin. So what you should tell, the membrane receptors are there. When hormone get attached to the alpha unit of receptor, beta unit shows the autophosphorylation and then protein kinase activity. Because of that enzyme, protein kinase, what is happening? Cell membranability changes and they allow the glucose to enter inside. So insulin helps the glucose molecules to enter inside the cell. Are you getting my point? So whenever diabetes mellitus happens, it is because of the two reasons. One is there is a deficiency of insulin. Is a typical deficiency is called as a insulin dependent diabetes mellitus, IDDM. That is called as a childhood diabetes. And second is a maturity onset diabetes is not insulin dependent diabetes. So there is not 100% deficiency, partial deficiency is there, but major problem is with the receptors. Are you getting? So receptors is important concept, and especially sulfonylurea type of the drugs, they increase the receptors number. And because of the increasing number of receptors, naturally this action of the insulin is easily taken place. So some drugs act at the central place, that is on the pancreas, and some act on the periphery to increase the receptors. Even it is said that why walking exercise is important for diabetes mellitus. Walking can increase this cell membrane receptors for insulin. Are you getting something important, physiological aspect, applied aspect? Anyway, after primary introduction of endocrine system or the hormones, we will try to see something about hormones of pituitary gland. Hormones of pituitary glands, they are totally 8 in number, major hormones. 6 hormones are from anterior pituitary and 2 hormones from posterior pituitary. Which are those 6 hormones from anterior pituitary? Growth hormone, GH. Thyroid stimulating hormone, TSH. Adrenocorticotrophic hormone, that is ACTH, adrenocorticotrophic hormone. Fourth one, follicle stimulating hormone, that is FSH. Fifth one, luteinizing hormone, that is LH. And sixth one is prolactin. These are all 6 hormones from anterior pituitary hormones. And posterior pituitary hormones are 2. One is antidiuretic hormone. Antidiuretic hormone, that is ADH and oxytocin. We will try to see one by one. First, we will concentrate on the anterior pituitary hormone, and the main hormone is growth hormone. Growth hormone is also called as somatotrophic hormone. Somatotrophic hormone. What is soma? Soma is a cell. Soma is a cell. And trophic means nourishment. So the hormone which gives nourishment to cells, that is called as growth hormone or somatotrophic hormone. This is secreted by acidophilic cells of anterior pituitary. Acidophilic cells of anterior pituitary. This is protein hormone. Remember, this is protein hormone. So naturally, action we have already discussed, that it will have the specific receptors at the cell membrane. Hormone will get attached, stimulation of adenyl cyclase, and that will change ATP to AMP, and cell membrane permeability will change, protein synthesis will start. Now we will talk about actions, physiological actions of GH. Basically, they can be explained in 3 ways. Number 1, indirect action. Number 2, direct action. And number 3, other actions. So first is a indirect action. The name itself, growth hormone, is essential for your physical growth. In the children, growth hormone acts more. So naturally the height and weight is increasing. Growth hormone acts on liver, remember, acts on liver and increases the production of somatomedins. In the liver, there is a chemical which is called as a somatomedin. Now, name itself, soma is a cell. Medins, it is a mediator, somatomedins. This somatomedin is also protein in nature. So, GH first acts on liver. Somatomedin C, somatomedin, there are different types of somatomedin. So, somatomedin capital C is physiologically important because it acts on cartilage and stimulates the growth. So, when it acts on cartilage and stimulates the growth, that is called as chondrogenesis. The word is a chondrogenesis. Also, chondroitin sulfate and collagen is deposited on the cartilages and bones. So, soft tissue also shows the growth because of this. Soft tissues also show the growth. So, I have talked to you about the indirect action of GH through the liver, through the somatomedin C. Is it clear? Now, we will go for the direct action. Growth hormone is acting on three metabolisms: protein, carbohydrate and fat metabolism. When we talk about growth, first we will see about protein. Growth hormone is anabolic. The word is anabolic. It increases the amino acid transport through the cell membrane. Amino acid transport through the cell membrane. Naturally, it increases the protein synthesis and messenger RNA, mRNA formation. Then there will be reduction in the protein breakdown, because this is anabolic hormone. So it will increase the protein, but protein lysis will be stopped. There will be no loss of protein. Protein will be preserved. This is called as a protein metabolism action, because it helps to transport of amino acids from here to there. It helps for protein synthesis and it also helps for mRNA formation. Messenger RNA is just taking one type of protein from here to another place. Suppose you want to build up the muscles. So messenger RNA will carry the typical proteins needed for the muscles. If I have to develop my femur, then typical proteins will be taken by messenger RNA to that particular site. So messenger RNA is a carrier of different types of the proteins needed by the body. Now what is the effect on carbohydrate? We have to preserve the body, no? We have to keep up the energy. So GH decreases the utilization of glucose, decreases the utilization of glucose and decreases the uptake of glucose, decreases the uptake of glucose. So naturally it will increase the BSL, blood sugar level is maintained or increased, because it is needed for the development of the body. Also, glucose is stored properly. So, glycogen deposition is stored more because of the GH. Sugar will be preserved, remember. Sugar will not be utilized because we need the energy. No? So, glycogen form will be stored in the liver. Then about fat metabolism. In the fat, GH increases the lipolysis. Fat is not needed, remember. We need the protein and we need the energy. So lipolysis takes place and FFA, free fatty acid level, will increase. Because we need the construction. So these fatty acids will be utilized as a energy. So, I have mentioned about the indirect action and the direct action. And now the other action of this GH, growth hormone. Growth hormone increases the calcium absorption from the intestine. Calcium absorption from the intestine, because it is also needed for the growth of bones. It also stimulates the erythropoiesis. Growth hormone is essential for RBC formation, hemoglobin formation, that is erythropoiesis. And last effect is it is very mild lactogenic effect. Lactogenic. But that is not much important in our practice. Now I will tell you how the regulation of this hormone takes place, how the GH hormone is maintained in a proper, the quantity in our blood, how it is maintained. Firstly, it is related to the hypothalamus, because growth hormone is directly not secreted. There is some stimulation from hypothalamus to pituitary. Remember, there is a connection, hypothalamus to pituitary. That is called as a neurohumoral or neuroendocrine control, neuroendocrine. Hypophyseal axis, that particular axis, imaginary axis, is called as a hypophyseal axis. Hypothalamus secretes, a typical name is there, What hypothalamus is secreting? Growth hormone releasing factor. Remember this name. Growth hormone releasing factor. That is from brain. That is from hypothalamus. That is called as GH-RF. GH-RF. What is that GH? Growth hormone. RF means releasing factor. So GHRF, who is secreting? Hypothalamus. And then there is also another factor against to that. That is called as GHIF. One is RF and second is IF. That is growth hormone inhibiting, inhibitory factor. One is releasing, another is inhibitory factor. Naturally, when pituitary will tell to the hypothalamus that I am having enough GH, so it will tell to the brain, stop the hormone. And that is controlled by growth hormone inhibitory factor. And those factors are also called as another name, synonym, another name, somatostatin. Somatostatin. Statin means to stop. Somatostatin. Somatostatin. You remember previously in the GH, in the liver there are somatomedins. Somatomedins. But here somatostatins. This is another name for GHIF inhibitory. Statin means to stop. Next. So this particular GHRF, they reach to the anterior pituitary and then growth hormone is secreted. Somatomedins secreted from liver, they give the negative feedback to the hypothalamus and then hypothalamus secrete the inhibitory factor. Are you getting my point? First GHRF is secreted, then pituitary secretes the GH, liver is stimulated, somatomedins are adequately coming up. Somatomedins give the signal to the brain. Enough somatomedins are there. So now stop. So they will send the somatostatin. This is the regulation of GH. Regulation of growth hormone. After seeing the basic nature, who is secreting acidophilic cell of the anterior pituitary is secreting protein in nature. We have seen the three types of physiological actions, regulation, and now we will go for abnormalities. Pathology in GH. We will talk about pathology in GH. So there are three types of pathologies. First, we will just write down the names. One is called as a gigantism. Gigantism. Another is a acromegaly. So both gigantism and acromegaly, this is excess. In Ayurveda it is called as a vruddhi. When GH is excess, then possibility of gigantism or acromegaly. But when it is less, that is called as a dwarfism. That is called as a dwarfism. So on the another side, hypersecretion, gigantism and acromegaly, less secretion, dwarfism. Too much height and too much short height. Okay? So we will see one by one. First is a gigantism. This is the excessive secretion of GH before the fusion of epiphysis. This is very important. Excessive secretion of GH before fusion of epiphysis of bones. That is in the childhood or in the young age. Okay? Before the fusion. And why? What is the basic current? What may be the basic current? Cause? Acidophil cell tumor. Acidophil cell tumor in anterior pituitary. This may be the main reason for excessive GH. There may be tumor. So you will have to do the CT scan or the MRI. Okay? What is happening? Clinical features of gigantism? That child, that young chap will be very tall, because epiphyseal growth is enhanced. It is not stopped. Epiphyseal growth is enhanced. Hands and legs will be too long. Extremities, hands and legs are TOO, too long. Not only bones, but even soft tissues are also more in number. Soft tissues are more in number. The effect is nose and ears are big. Your nose will be big and your ears will be also big. It's like a giant, appearance of a giant or demon. Then that particular child will show the secondary diabetes. Remember, we have seen the function of growth hormone. What is doing? It is anabolic in nature. So decrease the utilization of glucose, and glucose will be stored in the either in the liver as a glycogen or more in the blood, not in the cell. Remember, glucose will not be in the cell. So that's why, according to the physiological function of GH, more blood sugar will be there in the blood, and that is called as a secondary diabetes mellitus. Patient may complain of headache and vomiting because there is a tumor. Remember, headache and vomiting, that is called as a SOL, space occupying lesion is there. Space occupying lesion is in the brain, so it will increase the intracranial tension. Intracranial tension will increase and patient will suffer from the headache and vomiting. There may be, if the pressure, that tumor is pressing on the optic nerve, sometimes that pituitary is very near to the optic chiasma where the crossings of optic nerves are there. So if that pressure is giving on the optic nerve, that will be bitemporal on both sides, bitemporal hemianopia. This word is very important. Bilateral hemianopia. Bilateral hemianopia. Loss of vision on both sides, but only half part. That means I cannot see the right extreme and I cannot see the left. I can see in between, but I cannot see this and I cannot see right and left extremes. That is called as a hemianopia. And it is bilateral, right and left, because that tumor is pressing on the optic chiasma. Remember, where is the pathology? Tumor is pressing on the optic chiasma, CHRSMA. It is a crossing of optic nerve at the base of the brain, near the pituitary. Remember. But because of this, there may be suppression of other hormones. Remember, suppression of the other hormone. Only this hormone will be in excess. And what is the treatment? If it is a tumor, surgical intervention is expected. You have to just remove the particular tumor and patient may get a relief from his particular symptoms. So this is about the gigantism before the fusion of epiphysis. Now we will talk about acromegaly. ACRO. Acromegaly is also excess. It is also excess GH, growth hormone. But only the difference is, this is after the fusion of epiphysis. This is after the fusion of epiphysis. That means after the age of 21 in the adult. Acromegaly occurs in the adult. And this also can happen, again the same pathology, due to the tumor of acidophilic cells. So tumor may be in the children, tumor may be in the adult. If it is in the children, gigantism. If it is in the adult, acromegaly. Now let us see the symptoms or the clinical features. As the epiphysis is already fused, there will not be increase in the length of bones. Remember, length of bone cannot increase because epiphysis is an end where the cartilages are grown and height is more and more. But epiphyses are already fused. So vertically the bone cannot grow. Vertically the bone cannot grow. Length of the bone cannot be changed. Height of the bone cannot be changed. Then what will happen? Thickness. Remember, thickness of bone will increase. There will be more thickness of the bones. Especially flat bone. There are different types of the bones. Flat bones are commonly involved. So naturally, acromegaly patient will show big head. Head size, circumference will be big. Head will be more. Then this anteroposterior, this forehead protruding, coming forward. Forehead will be protruding. Head will be big. This lower jaw here, lower jaw, this bone also protrudes. So naturally what is happening? The whole face will be, or head will be bigger with compared to the body parts. Now what will happen with the extremities? Extremities will be more thick and stout, but they will be not long. In the gigantism, hands and legs are long, but here hands and legs are not long, but they are broad and very thick in nature. This is the difference of gigantism and acromegaly. Nose will be big, because this anterior nose bone will be flattened. This will not increase in height, it will be flattened. So nose will be also big one. Here also, inside, blood sugar level will be high, so secondary diabetes is also present in acromegaly due to the excessive growth hormone. Other features are same. Again, the tumor is there. So what will happen? Increased intracranial tension. Adult will also complain of headache and vomiting. Because these symptoms will be, even the visual abnormalities will be the same, because this is the pathology in the as a tumor. How that will be the blindness? That is called as a, what is the name for that? Bitemporal hemianopia. Bitemporal hemianopia. These words you must remember, because of the pressure on the optic chiasma. Again, this condition can be treated with surgical intervention. You have to remove the tumor. Sometimes it is treated with radiotherapy. Radiations can be given. So, of course, these cases are not very common in our medical practice. But yes, 1 or 2% you can see these patients. Dwarfism is more common. Now we'll talk about less secretion. That is called as a dwarfism. D-W-A-R-F-I-S-M. Dwarfism is a deficiency of a growth hormone. Deficiency of a growth hormone before puberty. Sometimes, not only growth hormone, but all pituitary hormones, like example, TSH, ACTH, FSH, LH, all hormones are suppressed, and that is called as a panhypopituitarism. Pan means total. Pan means total. Panhypopituitarism. So this is total suppression of all hormones. Then, skeletal growth of the child is stunted. Skeletal growth, bone growth of the child will be stunted. Naturally, height will be very less, like 3.5 or 4 feet height. Extremities are also short. But here, remember, we are talking about growth hormone. So basically, it is acting on the bones and not the brain tissue as such. So naturally, mental growth and reproductive growth is normal. Here, this is specialty. Although the person is looking very short in stature, don't get jumbling that he may be mental retarded. No, his mental age is very normal. And also reproductive growth is normal. Only the thing is, if it is a panhypopituitarism, then there will be deficiency of gonadotrophic hormones. Like FSH and LH will be reduced. And then there will be no secondary sex characters, or sexual growth will be hampered. But that is only in, if it is a panhypopituitarism, not only of GH. Here, sometimes the endocrinologist can suggest you the injections of growth hormone if it is properly diagnosed before puberty. So medical treatment is advisable, but again, if it is tumor like condition is there, tumor is pressing that gland, then tumor you have to remove surgically. So that is all about the treatment part of dwarfism. Either you give the anabolic steroids injections, or you have to, if it is tumor, then you have to remove it. So my dear friends, in this last 40 minutes, what we have studied, we have started with the topic of endocrine system. First, in the first part, I tried to explain you the what is hormone. It is a chemical messenger. It is circulated through the blood and directly acting on the target organs. Then we see the mechanism of protein hormones, mechanism of steroid hormones, mechanism of thyroid hormone, and mechanism of insulin hormone. Then we made the list of hormones of anterior pituitary. They are 6 from anterior pituitary and 2 from posterior pituitary. Then we started to study the action of growth hormone. This is protein hormone secreted by acidophilic cells. There are 3 types of actions: indirect action, direct action, and other action. Indirect is through liver. Direct is acting on the protein, carbohydrate, fat metabolism. Other action through the calcium absorption and erythropoiesis stimulant. And then we see the regulation. Regulation of GH. It is through the hypothalamo-hypophyseal axis. There are 2 types of the hormones. One is GHRF and another is GHRF. Then we see what are the abnormalities. Gigantism in the childhood and acromegaly in the adults because of the excess GH. And if its GH is less in adult or in childhood, that is called, basically it is related with the childhood, because epiphyseal growth can make you tall or short. So it is observed only in the childhood, that is called as a dwarfism. So I think because of the time restraint, we will stop here, and we will continue next time with the hormones of anterior or rather pituitary gland, and we will try to complete remaining hormones and their pathologies in the next lecture. Thank you very much. Have a nice day ahead. And please subscribe my YouTube channel for hearing these audio video lectures. Thank you.